This video is to accompany the Cisco Netacad Switching, Routing, and Wireless Essentials course. This video is Module 3, VLANs. In this video, we're going to look at the following objectives. We're going to explain the purpose of VLANs in a switch network, explain how a switch forwards frames based on a VLAN configuration in a multi-switch environment, configure a switch port to be assigned to a VLAN based on requirements, configure a trunk port on a LAN switch, and also to configure a dynamic trunking protocol, or DTP. 3.1, overview of VLANs. So let's look at the definitions of VLAN. A VLAN, they are logical connections with other similar devices. So by placing devices into various VLANs, we have the following characteristics. It provides segmentation of the various groups of devices on the same switches. It provides an organization that is more manageable. We can have broadcast, multicast, and unicast are isolated in the individual VLAN. And then each VLAN will have its own unique range of IP addressing. And then we can have smaller broadcast domains as well. Some of the benefits of using VLANs: you can have a smaller broadcast domain that divides the LAN and it reduces the number of broadcast domains. So you'll have a broadcast domain over here, a broadcast domain over here, and it reduces the domain. It has improved security, so only users in the same VLAN can communicate together. VLANs can group devices with similar requirements, such as faculty versus students. You can also have reduced cost. One switch can support multiple groups of VLANs, so instead of having two switches for two different LANs, you can have one switch for two VLANs. You can also get better performance. Small broadcast domains reduce traffic and improve bandwidth. And then similar groups will need similar applications and other network resources, so it makes the management simpler. So a default VLAN, and we're looking at VLAN 1 here, that's the default VLAN, the default native VLAN, the default management VLAN, and it cannot be deleted or renamed. While we cannot delete VLAN 1, Cisco does recommend that you assign the default features to other VLANs. You have data VLANs. Those are dedicated to user-generated traffic, such as email or web traffic. And then VLAN 1 is the default data VLAN because all interfaces are assigned to this VLAN. Then you have native VLAN. This is used for trunk links only. All frames are tagged on an 802.1Q trunk line, except for those on the native VLAN. And then we have a management VLAN. This is used for SSH, Telnet, VTY traffic and should not be carried with other end user traffic. And typically the VLAN that is the SVI for the layer 2 switch. A voice VLAN, we want to have a separate VLAN that's required because voice traffic requires assured bandwidth, high quality or high QoS priority, ability to avoid congestion, a delay of less than 150 milliseconds from source to destination, and the entire network must be designed to support voice. 3.2, VLANs in a multi-switched environment. Now, a trunk is a point-to-point link between two network devices. Cisco trunk functions include allowing more than one VLAN, extending the VLAN across the entire network, and then by default supports all VLANs, and it also supports 802.1Q trunking. Now, networks without VLANs, all devices are connected to the switch and they will receive unicast, multicast, and broadcast traffic. Networks with VLANs, unicast, multicast, and broadcast traffic is confined to that particular VLAN. So without a layer 3 device to connect the VLANs, devices in different VLANs cannot communicate with each other. The VLAN identification with a tag, the IEEE 802.1Q header is 4 bytes. When the tag is created, the FCS must be recalculated. And then when sent to end devices, the tag is removed and the FCS is recalculated back to its original number. Now, if we look at the basics of the 802.1Q trunk, tagging is typically done on all VLANs. The use of a native VLAN was designed for the legacy use, like the hub in the example over here. Unless changed, the VLAN 1 is the native VLAN, and both ends of a trunk link must be configured with the same native VLAN, and that each trunk is configured separately, so it is possible to have different native VLANs on separate trunks. Now, the voice over IP or VoIP phone is a 3-port switch. The switch will use CDP to inform the phone of the voice VLAN, and the phone will tag its own traffic, voice, and can set cost of service, or COS, under the COS for layer 2, and the phone may or may not tag frames from the PC. Here we have an example of the VLAN verification. The show interface FA0/18 switch port command shows us both data and voice VLANs that are assigned to that interface. 3.3, VLAN configuration. The VLAN ranges on catalyst switches. Catalyst switches 2960 and 3650 support over 4,000 VLANs. It's used in small to medium sized businesses. The extended VLAN range are used by service providers. The normal range here is 1,002 to 1,005. They're reserved for legacy VLANs. These are auto-created and cannot be deleted, 1,002 to 1,005. They're stored in the VLAN.dat file in the flash memory, and VTP can synchronize between the switches. On the extended range, they are in the running config file. It supports fewer VLAN features, and it requires VTP configurations. The VLAN details are stored in the VLAN.dat file. You can create VLANs in the global configuration mode. So you go into configuration mode, config terminal, set VLAN the ID, use the name command, the VLAN name, type in end, config terminal, and then you have configured the VLAN. So if the student PC is going to be the VLAN 20, we'll create the VLAN first and then name it. If you do not name it, the Cisco iOS will give it a default name of VLAN and the four-digit number of the VLAN. For example, VLAN 0020. I recommend always naming them with the LAN that it's going to be on with the logical name that you can recognize. Then once the VLAN is created, we can assign it to one of the correct interfaces. So you use the config terminal, interface, whichever interface you're using, switch port mode, set the ID, and then use the end command. You can then assign the VLAN to the port interface, and once the device is assigned to the VLAN, then the end device will need the IP address for that VLAN. And in this example, we're assigning it 172.17.20.22. An access port may only be assigned to one data VLAN. However, it may also be assigned to one voice VLAN for when a phone and an end device are off the same switch port. So you can port into or connect to your phone and then go from your phone to your end device and only have one connection. You don't have to run two lines. So when you want to create and name both voice and data VLANs, in addition to assigning the data VLAN, we also assign the voice VLAN and turn on QoS for the voice traffic to the interface. The newer catalyst switch will automatically create the VLAN if it does not already exist and when it's assigned to an interface. And a note on QoS, that's beyond the scope of what we're covering in this course, but we are going to show the use of MLS QoS trust command there. So we would set VLAN 20, the name, we'd set VLAN 150, name it to voice, set the interface, access, switch port VLAN 20, set the QoS, set the switch port to voice, and then end command. Then we can verify VLAN information. We can use the show VLAN command. We can also change VLAN port membership. There's a number of ways to change that. We can re-enter the switch port access VLAN ID, or we can use the no switch port access VLAN to place interface back into VLAN 1, or we can use the show VLAN brief or the show interface switch port commands to verify the correct VLAN association. Now, when we delete VLANs, we use the no VLAN and then the ID. But before deleting a VLAN, you want to reassign all the member ports to a different VLAN. And then when you delete all VLANs with the delete flash VLAN.dat or delete VLAN.dat commands, then you can reload the switch when deleting all VLANs. And then there's a note that to restore to factory default, you want to unplug all data cables, erase the startup config, and delete the VLAN.dat file, and then reload the device. 3.4, VLAN trunks. The trunk configuration commands, you can configure and verify VLAN trunks. Trunks are layer 2 and carry traffic for all VLANs. So you can do the config or con terminal, interface, set the ID, use the switch port mode trunk, switch port trunk native VLAN, and then your ID, switch port trunk allowed VLAN, and then exit privilege mode or return to privilege mode. This is a trunk configuration example. The subnets associated with each VLAN are the 172 here, the 10.0, 20.0, 30.0, and 99 with a slash 24. So we have VLAN 10 for faculty, 20 for students, 30 for guests, and 99 on the native. And then F01 port on the S1 is configured as a trunk port. And this assumes a 2960 switch using 802.1Q tagging. And then a layer 3 switches require the encapsulation to be configured before the trunk mode. Then we can verify trunk configuration. We set the trunk mode in native VLAN. SH interface FA01 switch port command is set to trunk administratively. It's also set as trunk operationally or functioning. Encapsulation is .1Q. Native VLAN is set to VLAN 99. And then all VLANs created on the switch will pass traffic on this trunk. You can also reset the trunk to the default state. All VLANs are allowed to pass traffic. Native VLAN is VLAN 1. And then you can verify the settings with the show interface FA01 switch port command. And then reset the trunk to an access mode with the switch port mode access command. 3.5, dynamic trunking protocol. The dynamic trunking protocol, or DTP, it's proprietary to Cisco. The characteristics have, by default, it's on a Catalyst 2960 or 2950 switch. The dynamic auto is default on the 2960 and 2950. It can be turned off with the no negotiate command. May be turned back on by setting the interface to dynamic auto. And then setting a switch to a static trunk or static access will avoid negotiation issues with the switch port mode trunk or switch port mode access commands. The switch port mode command has additional options. If you use the switch port no negotiate interface configuration command to stop the DTP negotiation, you can use access option. That is permanent access mode and negotiates to convert the neighboring link into an access link. You have dynamic auto. It becomes a trunk interface if the neighboring interface is set to trunk or a desirable mode. You have dynamic desirable that actively seeks to become a trunk by negotiating with other auto or desirable interfaces. And then you have trunk. That's a permanent trunking mode and negotiates to convert the neighboring link into a trunk link. And then the DTP configuration options are as follows: dynamic auto, dynamic desirable, trunk, and access. You can verify the DTP mode. The default DTP configuration is dependent on the switch or the iOS version on the switch. You can use the show DTP interface command to determine the current mode. And the best practice recommends that the interfaces be set to access or trunk and turn off DTP. So what did we learn in this module? We learned about VLANs, that they're logical. Each VLAN is considered a separate logical network. VLAN tag fields include the type, user, priority, CFI, and VID. An access port can belong to one data VLAN at a time, but may also have a voice VLAN. A trunk is a layer 2 link between two switches. IEEE 802.1Q tagging makes provisions for one native VLAN. An interface can be set to trunking or non-trunking. And then DTP is a Cisco proprietary protocol that manages trunk negotiations.